The Kingdom of Saudi Arabia is offering 1 million jobs to skilled Filipino workers. A special hiring program will be developed by Saudi Arabia and the Philippines to facilitate the hiring of new workers in the next 24 months. Aside from Saudi, the United Arab Emirates also wants to offer more jobs for Filipinos. The announcements come amid Kuwait's entry ban on new Filipino workers. The owners of the empty Princess Empress insist the sunken tanker that caused a massive oil spill in the Philippines is not an old vessel. They also told lawmakers they've already given aid to the affected communities. Vivian Gulia reports.
Please raise your right hand. Officials of RDC Reyield Marine Services, the company that owns the sunken MT Princess Empress, issued an apology on Monday as they faced a joint house panel investigating the massive oil spill from the incident.
We sincerely apologize to the communities, the local and national government and agencies. Elements beyond human control, such as sudden weather disturbance in the area, resulted in this unfortunate event.
But the company asserted the sunken oil tanker was not an old vessel, contrary to the Justice Department's opinion issued during the previous House committee hearing.
Newly constructed po yan. Maipapatunay ko po lahat ng mga steel plates at documents kung ano man po may bibigay ko po rito. Before the next hearing po, isasubmit ko po.
RDC Reyield Marine Services says it sent food packs to affected residents and is expecting $1 billion insurance coverage for oil pollution protection and indemnity.
How much premium did you pay?
Around $20,000 to $22,000.
Okay. You present within 5 days a copy of that insurance and a copy of that receipt of $20,000 to $22,000. Otherwise, okay, I will move for your contempt.
Over 41,000 families felt the brunt of the massive oil spill, according to DSWD records. And the agency's assistance has exceeded 611 million pesos, which include food and non-food items, emergency cash transfers, assistance for individuals in crisis situations, and cash for work. But for one LGU and a lawmaker, these are not enough.
Hindi sapat at delayed ang natatanggap na ayuda.
Until now, wala po talagang hanap buhay yung ating mga fisher folks. Sana makasuhan na po. For 3 months, wala pa rin pong nangyayari.
The oil spill also caused destruction to coral reefs in the area, estimated at 9.4 billion pesos, and mangroves estimated at 120.5 million pesos. Another lawmaker expressed concern over a supposed waiver affected residents are asked to sign.
Bibigyan daw sila ng 15K one time at hindi na sila pwedeng magdemanda pa later on pag nabigyan. So gusto ko lang ma-confirm ito.
Wala po akong alam sa waiver na yan.
3 more areas lifted fishing ban according to the Bureau of Fisheries and Aquatic Resources. These are Calapan, Bansud, and Gloria. The Philippine Coast Guard, meanwhile, remains optimistic it can beat the 4-month deadline for the oil spill cleanup. With a Monrovian-registered dynamic support vessel Fire Opal arriving in Oriental Mindoro, the Philippine Coast Guard says the siphoning of the remaining oil at the sunken tanker has already started. Vivian Gulia, ABS-CBN News.
The Philippine House of Representatives passes on third and final reading a bill declaring the country's maritime zones. These comprise of internal and archipelagic waters, territorial sea, continental shelf, and contiguous and exclusive economic zone. Lawmaker Rachel Arena said the measure will be beneficial in the country's pursuit of food and economic security, as well as promoting the Philippines' territorial integrity. The House will submit the bill to the Senate for action. Amid continuing tensions in the West Philippine Sea, Australia says Manila will play a huge role in this year's Indo-Pacific endeavor. The program is an annual regional engagement activity organized by the Australian Defense Force. It is meant to show Australia's commitment in working with regional partners to ensure a secure Indo-Pacific through maritime exercises. The IPE will be held in August this year.
This year's Indo-Pacific Endeavour is going to be probably one of the biggest we've ever done, with the Philippines right at the centre of it. Mm-hmm. And as part of that, we're actually running a an exercise called Alon. That is going to be an amphibious exercise, including the Philippines and most likely the US as well, and Australia, where we will be doing those operations.
The Philippines seeks to increase the number of its peacekeeping forces ahead of its bid for a seat in the United Nations Security Council for years 2027 to 2028. About 15,000 individuals have been deployed to peacekeeping missions since 1963, but the number dwindled due to various issues. The country's peacekeeping forces now only stand at 28. The Foreign Affairs Department says being part of the UN Council is essential to ensure the country's engagement in dialogues concerning peace and stability.
Well, we'll be able to engage in the most important dialogue and debates and vote even in important issues. We have, of course, an interest in the rule of law, international law, maintaining some peace and stability. It's very important. We have millions of Filipinos overseas. And we need the world to continue living and aspiring for the goals for which the UN was even created.
The Philippine House Ethics Panel recommends stiffer penalties for embattled lawmaker Arnolfo Teves Jr. But the man tagged as the mastermind in the murder of Negros Oriental Governor Roel de Gamo urges his colleagues to be fair should they put the recommendations to a vote. RG Cruz has the details.
Emerging from a closed-door executive session, the House Committee on Ethics and Privileges recommends stiffer penalties on Negros Oriental 3rd District Representative Arnolfo Teves Jr., who remains outside the country without the nod of the House. The panel believes this is disorderly behavior because under the House rules, members must act in a manner that reflects creditably to the institution.
The Committee on Ethics and Privileges unanimously decided to recommend to the plenary the imposition of a stiffer disciplinary action to our colleagues, Arnolfo Alni Ateves Jr. for violation of the rules of the House of Representatives, particularly Rule 20, Section 142, Subsection A and B of the Code of Conduct, and for disorderly behavior.
But in a virtual press conference, Teves disputes this.
Anong disorderly conduct sa pag-absent? Disorderly conduct po yung hindi ako sumunod sa kanila?
The panel did not allow full disclosure of the penalties, which means it won't be known till the plenary acts on the recommendation, on or before this Wednesday, when the 19th Congress adjourns its first regular session. But they rule out another suspension since their colleague already got the maximum 60-day suspension last March. However, for one panel official, this doesn't automatically mean expulsion.
Based on the House rules, the stiffer penalty from suspension is expulsion. And there is another penalty that can be imposed. Any penalty that the committee may determine. So yun na lang po yung mga natitirang options. But I'm not saying that yun po yung decision or recommendation ng committee.
Disability Affairs Secretary General Reginald Velasco says Teves Jr.'s case is unprecedented, as those who have been dropped from the roles of the House in the past had criminal convictions, while Teves has only been charged for murder before the Justice Department. Bongalon also explained that expelled lawmakers can always run again. Should the plenary put the recommendation to a vote, Representative Teves Jr. will have to wait till July 24 before he can appeal to his colleagues. Teves has an appeal to his colleagues this early.
Bumoto tayo sa naaayon sa batas at naaayon sa ating puso. It should be a collegial, real collegial decision, hindi yung decision na galing lang sa mando ng iisa.
The panel did not grant Teves' bid to join the proceedings electronically.
Wala naman akong warrant, wala naman akong kaso. Bakit ko kailangan magpakita physically? Unang-una, one-sided yan. This is a fact, di ba?
We really require the personal appearance of our respondent. This committee has really the option to really implement the whatever measures in order to protect the proceedings and how are we going to conduct our hearings.
Tevez's lawyer was also not allowed to face the panel in his behalf.
We will explore all legal avenues. We may go to the Supreme Court, we may go to the Ombudsman, we will see.
Hindi naman po talaga siya invited no, dito sa Committee on Ethics. And he wanted to appear on behalf of Congressman Arnulfo Tevez.
The panel plans to submit its recommendation to the whole House before it adjourns the first regular session of the 19th Congress on May 31st. RG Cruz, ABS-CBN News.
Several political parties reaffirm their alliance with Lakas CMD following a leadership row in the House of Representatives. In a statement, the Office of the House Speaker said at least seven parties signed an agreement with Lakas CMD reaffirming their alliance. These include the PDP Laban, National Unity Party, and Nacionalista Party. Under the agreement, the parties pledged to give their full support to President Ferdinand Marcos Jr. and to House Speaker Romualdez. Romualdez says it's a clear sign of their commitment to work together for the passage of the administration's pro-people legislative agenda. Rumors of a House coup surfaced last week, allegedly orchestrated by lawmaker and former President Gloria Macapagal Arroyo after she was demoted to Deputy Speaker. She has denied that allegation. And speaking of PDP Laban, Senator Robin Padilla has resigned as the party's executive vice president, but he clarified he will remain a member of the party. In a statement, Padilla said PDP Laban has much to achieve and it needs an executive vice president who can devote more time for the party. He believes his decision is for the good of the party, its members, and the Filipino people. Onto the controversial Maharlika Investment Fund Bill. Senate Minority Leader Coco Pimentel says the measure should outright ban state pension funds as its sources of investments. According to Pimentel, the Senate version of the bill allows the Social Security system and Government Service Insurance System to voluntarily invest in the Maharlika Fund. He believes it's a cause for concern.
Gawin ng imposible o bawal. Opo, opo. Mm. Opo, yan din po ang aking panawagan o ang aking stand na gawin ng bawal. Then, then para tapos na yung usapan at hindi tayo parating nakabantay, nag-worry tayo kung naglagay ba ng pera sa isang entity na ang kanyang mandato, ang utos sa kanya ng batas is maging agresibo ka eh. Pag-invest, paano kikita ang funds sa ngayong panahon? Bagsak ang world economy, ang taas ng inflation, ang daming nagsasara.
Pimentel also doubts the safeguards of the MIF bill are enough to prevent huge losses or corruption. The Senate is looking to approve the bill this week.
Yung mga safeguards po na binanggit, eh, alam nyo naman na sa mga funds, kahit sa government agency na ang dami rin namang safeguards, may ombudsman pa tayo, nagpifail yung mga control mechanisms, nagpifail yung systems, kaya naiisahan, nananakawan ng mga government agencies. Tulad nitong MIF, kahit na nakasulat lahat yung safeguards na yan, by conscious design, kayang lusutan yun, lalo na dahil ito'y about investment.
Other top government officials, meanwhile, expressed support for the Maharlika Investment Fund Bill. Central Bank Governor Felipe Medalla believes there are enough safeguards within the measure to ensure it won't be detrimental to government's fiscal health. For House Speaker Martin Romualdez, it might play a role in boosting the Philippine stock market.
The bill as it is now is okay. This is no longer a sovereign wealth fund. It's now more a national development fund, right? It's now an investment fund.
The corporation that will be created to manage the Maharlika Investment Fund will value look PSP in its search for blue chip investment opportunities from which handsome dividends may be generated. Dividends which shall be channeled to the fund of the government's strategic and social programs towards the achievement of the nation's larger developmental goals.
Philippine Finance Secretary Benjamin Diokno defends the Internal Revenue Bureau for going after the local stock market over its alleged unpaid taxes. The Philippine Stock Exchange has said it would challenge a BIR finding that it has over 189 million pesos in tax deficiencies in 2017. Diokno says it's part of the BIR's mandate.
Ginagawa lang naman ng BIR yung trabaho niya. That's really their job. And the customs ganun din. So we are putting pressure on both collecting agency. Meron kaming program, revenues nila for this year, next year, and hanggang 2028. So they're just doing their job.
The trading floor of the Philippine Stock Exchange gets a new look nearly a year after it was closed down. Jackie Pascual gives us a peek in this report.
It was June last year when the Philippine Stock Exchange's trading floor shut down for good, marking the PSE's transition to 100% digital trading amid the pandemic. Almost a year later, the floor has been transformed into the new PSE Events Hall. Traders' desks have been removed, the floor and walls have changed, and the huge screen hanging in the middle of the floor has been replaced. What remains are the stock ticker screens, and there's a new large market data board.
Since this events hall will be the venue for IPO, FOO, and SRO listing ceremonies, we are one in our desire to see the local capital market catch up with its peers in the region. We all understand the urgent need for new products and proactive regulations to improve liquidity in the stock market.
Top government officials attended the inauguration of the new events venue and said this is a good move for the local bourse.
This hall represents what could be in the future. An economy where capital markets are more developed. An economy where funding of big projects and activities could be funded by thousands, hopefully even millions of people.
The opening of this listing ceremonies venue and the unveiling of the market data board signify our shared objective of promoting transparency, growth, and development of the capital markets.
We are counting on you to be a strong engine in the development of our capital markets by powering the Philippine equities market with advanced technologies, widely accessible market information, transparency, and robust risk management.
2, 1.
Ayala Corporation officials also joined the event to mark a successful share sale.
Ayala is delighted to be listing its 3.1 million preferred shares issue right here, right now, will support our company's many growth initiatives. These initiatives are testimony to the Philippines' renewed growth.
The PSE needs a boost. Its average daily trading value went down by 5.5% year-on-year in the first quarter of 2023. This measure is generally seen as an indicator of market activity and investor interest. Jackie Pascual, ABS-CBN News.